You're listening to the BBM Global Network with 25 years in broadcast audio and video production. Our passionate team creates content and marketing for the world of internet talk radio. If you've got a passion, come join us at bbmglobalnetwork.com. The BBM Global Network. Your voice is now heard.
Welcome to Soulstream Talk with your host, Rebecca Ann, your new resource for soul path, past life, energy healing, and astrological information and guidance. Rebecca Ann is here to help you move into greater clarity and self-empowerment by offering direct on-air guidance. So now, welcome the host of Soulstream Talk, Rebecca Ann.
Everyone, welcome to you. I'm Rebecca Ann, and you are listening to Soulstream Talk. We're coming to you live from the BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. And this is a new kind of program for a new era in human consciousness and your new resource for all things mind, body, soul, and spirit. And I'm really excited about today's show because it's all about karma, lessons, and reincarnation, which are really big ideas that a lot of people have adopted and are working with. And there are a whole lot of ideas out there about karma and soul lessons and reincarnation. But based on my personal studies and healing and growth process, along with a couple of decades spent working with clients on their spiritual development and soul path issues, I have come across a number of very commonly embraced misconceptions about karma and reincarnation that are actually hindering people rather than helping them in their efforts to heal and thrive and grow into new places emotionally and spiritually. I think the best place to begin maybe talking about this is to bring up that a Western shift toward Eastern spirituality and practices that began about 50 years ago has now become so mainstream that if you were born in the 1970s or later, you might not even know that it was only when hippies began embracing and exploring Eastern spiritual traditions back in the late 1960s that Eastern traditions and practices first began to appear in Western societies. Most people in the West, in Europe and in America certainly, knew nothing about Eastern traditions prior to that. And there certainly weren't any places where Westerners in the West, in Europe and America, could learn about, much less participate in group practices like yoga, meditation, chanting, qigong, acupuncture. Not only were they almost unheard of, but you couldn't go somewhere, or go online and find a class or a group that was practicing consciousness development. It just was not out there. And the people who brought it into our Western world and consciousness to the point where it is today, which is, my God, there are hot stone massage over a truck stop in Georgia that I encountered a couple of years back when I was taking a road trip. Lots of strip malls and most neighborhoods, even in small towns, have yoga centers. This was not the case before, But along with the concepts of meditation and yoga, chanting as means to upgrade and create a higher spiritual awareness for yourself, upgrade your awareness and create a higher spiritual awareness for yourself, come some ideas about reincarnation and soul lessons that, from my perspective, working with clients and based on my own healing process, is really a distortion. Another aspect of consciousness change that came in back in the 60s youth culture was the embrace of some Native American practices and ceremonies, along with the use of psychedelics in the form of peyote and mescaline, LSD, that were taken for the purpose of consciousness expansion and in order to have spiritual experiences. This was not just to get high, as is mostly publicized in texts that you read. And this is what initially gave rise to the consciousness exploration and metaphysical journeying types of information and practices and learning centers that are also so readily available now. And I bring that up because it's hand in hand with the Eastern traditions. So, but along with the popularity and constantly expanding availability of things like yoga, chanting, and meditation. And now a lot of people are taking ayahuasca journeys in South America in order to also attempt to experience higher spiritual realities and journey in metaphysical ways. Along with that, there has been a wholesale embrace of the idea. And I've heard this again and again and again, that we reincarnate again and again and again. And we reincarnate according to our karma that we've accrued in previous lives and the lessons that we need to learn from that karma. And we keep coming back until we learn enough and become enlightened enough to ascend and ascend into higher consciousness and graduate from the Earth planet life and come into a state where we no longer have to reincarnate here, but can instead live in a heavenly sphere freed from rebirth. And if you think about it, this sounds quite suspiciously like going to heaven upon death story from Christian teachings. But this whole concept that we're all here to ascend, to suffer until we master ourselves through development, and then we ascend and don't have to come back, is a very deeply rooted concept among all kinds of people who are practicing various kinds of Native American and holistic and Eastern traditional types of devotion and practice. And so this Christian idea of ascending into heaven is actually, of course, a very old world, old age view. And it was first put forth by the Buddha in 6th century CE. And this is just the beginning of an unfolding of all kinds of distortions. So I am Rebecca Ann. You are listening to Soul Stream Talk. We're on the Bold Brave Media Network and TuneIn Radio, and it is time to slip into a little break, but when we come back, we're going to go deeper into these misconceptions.
Mike Zorich, a three-time California state champion in Greco-Roman wrestling at 114 pounds. Mike, blind since birth, was born in Hartford, Connecticut. He was a six-time national placer, including 2 seconds, two-thirds, and two-fourths. He also won the Veterans Folkstyle Wrestling twice at 152 pounds. In all these tournaments, he was the only blind competitor. Nancy Zorich, a creative spirit whose talents have taken her to the stage and into galleries and exhibitions in several states. Her father, a commercial artist who shared his instruments with his daughter and helped her fine-tune her natural abilities, influenced her decision to follow in his footsteps. Ms. Zorich has enjoyed a fruitful career doing what she loves. Listen Saturday mornings at 12 Eastern for the Nancy and Mike Show for heartwarming stories and interesting talk on the BBM Global Network.
Attorney Renee Marie Smith is changing the way we sell real estate. She wrote a series of books called My Short Sale Guru Guides for all real estate practitioners. Whether you're a homeowner wanting to understand the process, an agent who has been handling short sales for years, or an industry analyst wanting to know how short sales impact your business, Renee uses her vast real estate experience to take a comprehensive look at the recent market phenomenon while relaying it in an easy-to-understand format. Through her company, Smith Title Services, Renee has counseled thousands of short sale participants and processed in excess of 1,000 short sales. Her knowledge is transformational for real estate professionals and laymen alike, and her live presentations provide people the opportunity to ask specific questions about their issues. Buy her books and schedule her to speak at your next event. Visit www.smithtitleservices.com or call 305-705-3428 or email her at renee@smithtitleservices.com. Isn't it time to sell your property today? Learn the My Short Sale Guru way.
Welcome back, everyone, to Soul Stream Talk. I am your host, Rebecca Ann, and we are coming to you live from the BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio, as well as Spotify. And this is a new kind of program for a new era in human consciousness. And what we're talking about today is that new era in human consciousness in terms of reincarnation, karma, and Eastern spiritual practices. Before the break, I was talking about how the sort of dual incoming interest and practice of various spiritual traditions, along with consciousness expansion and Native American practices, and the use of consciousness expanding helpers like peyote, mescaline, and LSD were things that were brought into our society about 50 years ago, but have now really picked up steam. And but I also was talking about how a lot of people who sort of left behind the concept they were growing up, they grew up with of how, you know, Christianity works and Judaism work, came out of that and looking for greater consciousness, and then have adopted this pretty ancient concept of reincarnation and karma. And it's so having left off with these punishing and judgmental concepts of God or Christ, which I have to say, absolutely, I think are human devised distortions of the original messages about loving and forgiveness, helping suffering and downtrodden people, and that the kingdom and queendom of heaven lie within each one of us, that we all have the spark of the divine in us, and that what we're here to do is clear out, uncover, and claim and live from that sacred place of our own higher selves. So this was an original message of Western religions, and then there are the Eastern ones embraced, but so many people think of it as karma is here to judge. It's about judgment. It's about doing wrong. It's about being bad. So I see people just replacing those kind of old world Christian or Judaic views with an equally old world, old age scattering of Eastern perspectives. And I think it's clear to most people that the new age and the new paradigm, the great awakening we're living through right now, which began infiltrating human consciousness in the late 60s, but by now is really full steam ahead in many, many quarters of society, with lots more people being born or coming to maturity with a lot higher consciousness. It also calls for a new understanding of the old world Eastern concepts of karma and reincarnation, every bit as much as it calls for updated and undistorted views of classic Christianity and Judaism. Now, just to be clear here, the difference between Christianity and Judaism is that Christians believe in individual salvation from sin through receiving Jesus Christ as their Savior, and Jews believe in individual and collective participation in eternal interaction with God through tradition, rituals, prayers, as well as ethical actions. And Christians generally believe in a three-faceted God. As a kid growing up in the Catholic Church, it was the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But it's a three-faceted God, one part of whom became a human, Christ. Judaism emphasizes the oneness of God and rejects the Christian concept of God in human form. But the Western message has to do, and I'm including both Judaic and Christian practices, has a lot to do with judgment of behavior and being bad or good. And I was really surprised last week when a friend of mine, she has a mental health background career-wise, but she's been doing Akashic Record readings and healings for the last few years. And I also work as an Akashic Records consultant and an energy healing science practitioner. I'm also an astrologer, and I've been doing it longer than her. But I mean, she's a very gifted person and helps a lot of people, and having a mental health background really helps her do that. But she told me last week how she wonders all the time what the karma of neuroses is. And the idea of the karma of neuroses is something, well, never crossed my mind. She specializes in working with people who've been severely traumatized physically and emotionally. And many of them exhibit neuroses until the healing of their karma becomes complete. And that's why she was focusing on neuroses. She's like, I keep wondering what the karma of neuroses is. I don't work with the same population she does. I mostly work with people seeking support for spiritual expansion and greater understanding of how to engage mental and emotional abilities they have in ways that complement their spiritual paths. So we do have pretty different practices in that respect. But it's when she said how she wonders what the karma of neuroses is all the time that I got the idea for today's show. Because, hey, that just sounds like something that needs to be addressed in light of the perspective I've been able to gain from the work I've been doing the last 25 years. I am Rebecca Ann. I am your host on SoulStream Talk. We're on the BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. And when we come back, we're going to dive right into more of an update for the concepts of karma. So you won't want to miss that. Please stay tuned.
Psychologist, master certified coach, and CEO of the executive and organizational development firm True North Leadership, Dr. Relly Nadler brings his expertise in emotional intelligence to keynotes, consulting, coaching, and training. He is the author of Leader's Playbook and Leading with Emotional Intelligence that lays out tips and tools for effective leadership. Dr. Nadler has designed multi-day executive boot camps for high achievers in Fortune 500 companies and has coached CEOs, presidents, and their staff, and developed and delivered innovative leadership programs for such organizations as Anheuser-Busch, BMW, MCI, EDS, DreamWorks Animation, the U.S. Navy, and Vanguard Health Systems. To learn more and get your free iPhone app highlighting his tools with videos, Leadership Keys, visit www.truenorthleadership.com today.
Are you looking for employment and live in Los Angeles, Orange, Riverside, and San Bernardino counties? Jobs Annex is the place for you. Are you an employer looking to fill a position or quite a few positions in Los Angeles, Orange, Riverside, and San Bernardino counties? Jobs Annex is for you. Employers, JobsAnnex.com is your resource for career-minded people. JobsAnnex.com is the convenient place for job seekers and employers to hook up and move forward. Jobs Annex has been serving Los Angeles, Orange, Riverside, and San Bernardino counties for over 14 years. Jobs Annex is a former employment search firm. We've evaluated many thousands of resumes, and we understand what employers want and what job applicants need to be successful in their interviews. At Jobs Annex, we provide you with the tools to tell your story for free. Our resources at JobsAnnex.com will help each applicant construct an award-winning resume, an eye-catching cover letter, and key interview questions to ask in various types of interviews. Best of all, it's free. JobsAnnex.com. That's JobsAnnex.com.
Welcome back, everyone, to SoulStream Talk. And we're on the BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. I'm really glad you're tuning in. If you have a question or a comment, you can call in at 866-451-1451. That's 866-451-1451. And today's show, as we were talking about before, is all about karma, reincarnation, and soul lessons that we're here to learn. And in the last segment, I brought up how a lot of people seem to have taken wholesale the Eastern concepts of karma and reincarnation and lessons and put them into kind of bizarre framework where it's almost like the whole same sin and punishment idea that comes from Judaic or Christian traditions. And I work with a lot of people, and I have for a long time, and I'd say about 95% of the people I work with as clients, many of whom practice yoga and meditation and or chanting. They're on spiritual paths. They're definitely working to develop and transcend just their most ordinary state and become more conscious beings and better people. But about 95% of them assume that reincarnation and spiritual growth work by, it's like we make mistakes, then we pay for them through karma, and then slowly over time, we come into a new state of being. Now, a higher spiritual state. And I used to believe that too, as a matter of fact. But the truth is that as I think about and am bringing this to you today, I just have to address it. It drives me nuts when people think of karma as what kind of karma am I incurring, or what, think of the bad karma someone else is incurring. There's this whole idea of bad and good karma, which is a distortion in itself. Karma is simply a term for action and reaction. It is not bad or good. It is not tit for tat. In other words, if you kill someone in one life, it doesn't mean you'll be killed in the next life to balance that out. If you stole things, if you were a thief in one life, it doesn't mean you're going to be a thief in the next life. If you harmed someone physically, it doesn't mean you're going to be harmed physically in the next life to teach you your lesson. For example, you might have killed someone in a life, and then the next one you'd become a homicide investigator to learn more about what it's like to be on the other side. You might have been a thief in one life, and then in a new life, you are devising safety systems to help people so things can't be stolen. But this idea that human struggles are karmic punishment for having been bad, and that if you can just figure out how to be better or act better, you will be able to reduce your karma, and then you won't have to struggle so much. And to me, this is just that same old sin, punishment, and atonement cycle wrapped in the language of old world Hindu beliefs. And from this view, instead of using practices and insight and consciousness expansion to grow into and live from a place of higher consciousness, this distorted view of karma and lessons seems to be more, at least in all the thousands of people I've worked with and talked with about this, the idea that I'll refrain from doing things out of fear of judgment or retribution or punishment. I refrain from them to avoid the bad karma that I would incur, which is, you know, that's not a very high consciousness to fear retribution so you then curtail your actions. How about going into a state of consciousness where you have such inner peace and such an awareness of the higher aspects of life, even as all the lower aspects are still in full manifestation, that you see it through a different lens of consciousness, and you just don't want to do things that are harmful or vengeful or, that your motivation changes deep within you. And so you act differently because you are different and you've transcended a little bit your ordinary human consciousness, which tends to be emotional and operating out of the lower chakras and reactive. But as we grow into the higher chakras, or where the consciousness development takes place in our energy anatomy, and as we start operating from there, someone who does something, we don't go, oh my God, I'm going to flip them the bird because they cut me off in traffic. We don't refrain from it because they might come at us. We refrain from it because we don't think that way. We don't assume that other people are hostily trying to have an impact on us, even if they may be having an adverse impact. It's like we see things from the point of view of a flow, and that things happen, and they're not pointed at us particularly. And that way we are coming from a much more place of flow, a place of ease and goodwill, that it's not about disciplining ourselves to act certain ways. It's about feeling different, so we act in different ways. And this is the kind of change I think people are after. And I'm Rebecca Ann. This is Soulstream Talk. We're on the BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio. It is time to slip in another little break. But when we come back, I'm going to talk about how you can move into that consciousness and how you can get off any wheel of karma as you go forward. And you won't want to miss that, so please stay tuned.
Author, radio show host, and coach John M. Hawkins reveals strategies to help gain perspective, build confidence, find clarity, achieve goals. John M. Hawkins' new book, Coached to Greatness, Unlock Your Full Potential with Limitless Growth, published by iUniverse. Hawkins reveals strategies to help readers accomplish more. He believes the book can coach them to greatness. Hawkins says that the best athletes get to the top of their sport with the help of coaches, mentors, and others. He shares guidance that helps readers reflect on what motivates them, rediscover and assess their core values, philosophies, and competencies, find settings that allow them to be the most productive, and track their progress towards accomplishing goals. Listen to John Hawkins' My Strategy, Saturdays, 1 p.m. Eastern on the BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio.
Hey, welcome back, everyone, to Soul Stream Talk. I'm your host, Rebecca Ann. We're on the BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio, as well as Spotify. If you have a question or comment about today's show, please do call in at 866-451-1451. That's 866-451-1451. And we air every Tuesday at 2 p.m. Eastern. Every show is also archived, so if you go to boldbravemedia.com and click on my page, you can scroll down and listen to all the, I think it's 21 shows that I've done so far. And today's show is, if you're just tuning in, is all about karma, reincarnation, and soul lessons. And in the earlier part of the show, I've gone into great detail about how a lot of people who kind of left behind the beliefs they were brought up with then have embraced Eastern practices and traditions, meditation, chanting, Qigong, yoga, etc. But along with that, they've replaced very old age concepts of karma and reincarnation, such that, you know, you slowly reincarnate life after life after life and slowly learn from the retribution that comes from your bad karma as you're moving toward ascension. And then eventually you're enlightened, you ascend, you go to a, you know, heavenly place and don't have to come back to the earth, where life on earth is hard. But a lot of people tend to confuse that fact, which has always been a fact. I mean, if survival is a lot easier today than it was when you had to create your own candles and slay all your own animals and chop wood for your warmth. So, yeah, we have it easier today. But this idea that if you just do exactly the right things and you won't incur any more karma and then you can ascend and you will become free from the struggles and suffering of human life. Now, you can become that internally, but it doesn't make external realities and struggles go away. And there is no perfect behavior or perfect control over what happens to you. And thinking about things that way, it's like people talk a lot about we're creating our own reality. And so the idea is if we create our own reality, then we'll monitor all behavior and do everything right, and then we won't have pain or struggle anymore. And this leaves out the fact that life just isn't easy. And even if you do everything right, and even when you're moderately secure in terms of health, safety, and finances, life is still just life. And we don't create all our own reality. I mean, you may, if you're at all a part of sort of the new age practitioner world, you've probably heard people say, oh, she got cancer. I wonder why she created that for herself. Or, oh, you sprained your ankle. Why did you create that for yourself? Well, the truth is, these are things that happen. And while we may draw a lesson from it, like, hey, don't run so fast and forget to look where your feet are going, you might trip and sprain your ankle. You know, that can be the lesson, to walk more mindfully. It doesn't necessarily mean you have a deep karmic soul lesson to learn. Similarly, people do contract diseases. That's part of life in a human body. And even people who are extraordinarily health conscious and do, you know, have a very specific health diet and exercise all the time, it doesn't relieve us from possibly having physical conditions or illnesses. So this idea that if we are just good enough, then we will be freed, takes part of the idea of, like the Buddha's idea was, we suffer because of our attachment. But this idea that, oh, because we create our own reality, if we change our behavior, then we don't have to suffer. That's not what it's about. It's about an internal shift of consciousness where we're not attached to outcomes. So if we or someone we love, you know, falls ill or dies or gets in an accident, all these things that can happen to people, goes into a period of financial struggle, has a sad or dangerous relationship, that we aren't attached to those things. We can have inner peace in spite of them, not that we can then change our behavior, have better karma, and get a free pass from the human condition. That pain, retribution, and karma, I think for a lot of people is an effort or a desire to have control over what happens. And while we do create our own reality to some extent, and we do have a lot of choices for sure, the idea that we alone create our reality discounts the very nature of the reality we live in, which is much bigger than us and is not subject to our small and personal shift of vibration. And the idea that we have the power to keep anything adverse from striking us is pretty fairy tale-like. And it's also, if you're thinking about these, a new outlook on the ideas of karma, some of the other ideas about karma and birth, rebirth from ancient Hinduism have to do with being born into rigid and totally fated caste systems, where you're born in a low-level caste and you must live there and suffer a whole life. And then maybe when you're reborn, you can go a little higher in the social order. I mean, those are pretty screamingly in contradiction to all the new thought and new consciousness concepts that most people who are practicing Eastern spiritual practices are trying to live for. Things like embracing equality and diversity. These are ideas that are not a part of karma and old ideas of karma. And in the same way that it's critical to come into new consciousness generally, if you're so minded, it's also, I think, critical to let go of some of these old world ideas about karma. I am Rebecca Ann. We're on the BBM Global Network, TuneIn Radio, and Spotify. This is Soul Stream Talk, and we're going for a little break. When we come back, we're going to talk about real new consciousness and quantum leaps. You'll want to stay tuned for that.
Have you ever wondered why some children recover from their symptoms of autism while others never seem to get any better? After 13 years of research, Karen Thomas has recovered her own son from his symptoms of autism naturally. She now shares how she did it with you in her free webinar so that you can have the right resources and knowledge to help your child. The definition of recovery is to regain health. Karen offers this to you in four stages: healing the gut, natural heavy metal detoxification, balancing the co-infections of autism, brain support, and repair. Register now for this free webinar to help you know what you can do to help your child to sleep better, be more calm, improve focus, and reach their fullest potential to live a happy, healthy life. Go to naturallyrecoveringautism.com/free workshop, empowering parents with the resources to naturally recover autism from a mom who's done it.
Welcome back, everyone, to Soul Stream Talk. I am Rebecca Ann, your host. We're on the BBM Global Network, TuneIn Radio, and Spotify. And if you have a comment or question, you can call in at 866-451-1451. That's 866-451-1451. And prior to this particular segment, we got up to the point in talking about karma, where I was talking about how the very nature of reality is a lot given. We don't have the power to completely create our own reality, nor through choosing our behavior or food or schedules are we able to stave off all sad or uncomfortable experiences from the human condition. But what we can do is realize that a lot of those outmoded ideas of karma are as outmoded as different Judaic and Christian concepts. And I am not including other religions in that umbrella here simply because I don't know enough about them to speak to them. This may be equally true for faiths that I don't know about or know enough about to talk with. But the idea of a new era in human consciousness, the great awakening that's going on, all the souls that are being born with higher consciousness, and all the people who are really wanting to evolve in terms of their perspective and their consciousness and shift how they feel and how they experience their lives from day to day. These ideas are growing. It's, you know, the ideas of diversity and being humane to everyone and people having certain basic rights at a global level, like to be safe, to be able to get health care, to be able to be considered equal regardless of their gender preference or identification. The idea of sharing resources rather than hoarding them. Sustainability is huge and will be growing. And this is within a framework of we're all responsible for ourselves and others and the impact we have, but not in the way that we're like monitoring our behavior so, you know, we don't act bad and then we don't create karma. No, it's the idea of transforming your perspective, seeing things through a lens of the flow that you might experience when you're out in the woods or when you're by the ocean or when you're with someone you love deeply listening to music or with a group of friends that you're really close to, and you move into a vibration of lovingness, things feeling good, that it feels blissful being together. And that you, far from monitoring your behavior so you don't act wrong, you have goodwill that emerges from your heart by itself. You have a goodwill toward all feeling. And as that pours out of you, it's actually a form of light, divine light. We all have divine light. It can pour through you and out of you, and you can share that with others. And other people, if they're in the same frequency, they can be doing the same. And the whole concept is building up this identification with our original divine nature in a way that creates a better world. And ultimately creates a more peaceful world and a sustainable one that does not harm others or the environment. And there are a whole lot of people who have the experience, and you can too, especially if you think about it, the experience that you're going, you know, things do not just happen in a cycle and a slow, like you have to have 10 lives to move 10 notches up the karmic scale. Things happen in instants, in quantum leaps. I do know people that have gone on like ayahuasca journeys and suddenly became very aware of much greater realities and other dimensional realities. And it shifted in the instant for the rest of this life and other lives, their perspective on who they are and how they function in reality, in their current reality as incarnate and in other realities when they're out of body. It's also important to mention that a lot of old souls who are incarnate today or are incarnating, especially ones who are working to help raise vibrations, promote healing and peace, they are not here to work out karma or because of karma. Many people who are here right now, incarnate, reached enlightenment or ascended already and don't have to come back here. But they love Earth, they love humanity, and they chose to return to help give birth to this new era that's going to be unfolding over the next 100 years. Started 50 years ago, going to be unfolding over the next 100. The misconception is that, and a lot of people, even that are souls who volunteered to come in, that if you return under those circumstances and you're already enlightened or ascended, that when you come and incarnate, you will be free of human challenges and struggles. And that simply isn't true. In fact, struggling, challenges, and things that happen in the physical when you're incarnate are just a part of the nature of life. And once you come into this human life in a body, whether you're a very elevated soul or not, then you have human experiences. You can devolve too. You can make choices where you devolve, but this idea that somehow if we do just the right blend of behavior, we'll be free of karma and we won't have to come back. When I have clients who ask me a lot about not wanting to have to reincarnate again, the work we do is not to take them to that place, because I don't believe in that place. I believe most souls who ascend come back to help, and that's part of their enlightenment. But to help people move into the kind of expanded, elevated, and blissful experiences of being in the moment, alive right here now, that make the whatever suffering or ailments or struggles you have in day-to-day life, make them much less a problem for you. So you shift consciousness and nothing external changes, but internally you have a lovely new experience. I am Rebecca Ann. This is Soulstream Talk. We're on the BBM Global Network, TuneIn Radio and Spotify, and it's time for another little break. And when we come back, it's time for the astrological feature of the week. So stay tuned.
There are artists, and then there's Alice Asmar. This award-winning artist has spent her entire life devoted to her artistic pursuits and has had a lifelong fascination with American Indians of the southwestern United States. Her book, Dance to the Great Spirit, showcases her drawings and paintings inspired by sacred rituals of the Pueblo Indians, and four of her lithographs are in permanent collection at the National Museum of American History and the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. She is one of four artists in the United States to win a Woolley Fellowship for study in Paris at L'École des Beaux-Arts and has been featured in numerous publications. She's exhibited at the world's most prestigious museums and galleries and recently won a 20-year service award from the Burbank City Council and the inaugural art competition of the Foundation of the United States in Paris.
Visit www.asmarart.com, www.aliceasmarinternational.com, and email Alice at aliceasmar@aol.com.
Welcome back, everyone, to Soulstream Talk. I'm Rebecca Ann. We're on the BBM Global Network and TuneIn Radio, and this is a new kind of program for a new era in human consciousness and your new resource for all things mind, body, soul, and spirit. We air at 2 p.m. Eastern every Tuesday, and we've been through a whole show now about shifting consciousness so that rather than changing the external and supposedly changing your karma, you're changing your consciousness and your internal state. So whatever is happening outside is experienced differently, and that you can have more peace and bliss within. Not a very peaceful astrological lineup that I've got to talk about here. In the last couple of weeks, I talked about how Saturn and Pluto, which is Saturn is restriction and form, and Pluto is like a excavator clearing away things that don't work, how they're in Capricorn opposite Cancer. The Cancer North Node, and the North Node is about what we came here to master and learn. Well, I talked about those. Now planet Mars, which is the activator planet, it pushes you into movement. It's like the get up and do it energy, and it triggers anything it touches, and that includes as it goes through all the houses of the horoscope, and also as it contacts any planet or points in a chart, luminaries, and also the north or south node. And that's important because right now Mars is at 17 degrees Cancer. And between today and this Friday, it will be activating the north and crossing the north node Cancer at 19 degrees. And what we can expect from this is shakeups that sort of force you to move forward if you've been dragging your feet. It could also mean new visions and new insights as to how to proceed in your life in new ways that you may have been working on for a really long time or not feeling clear about. But with Mars activating that north node, it could be like the shock that shifts you into the quantum leap of consciousness change that we were talking about early in the show. So it can, like all planetary configurations, have a light and shadow expression. And the light expression of a Mars trigger, especially on the North Node, which is about what we came to do that we haven't done before and came to master that we haven't mastered before in this life. Having Mars activate that is really an opportunity to go in new directions. And Saturn is exactly opposite that Pluto, and Saturn that are conjunct in Capricorn. So rather than simply having this revolutionary excavation energy of Pluto and the restrictions and the structuring of Saturn. Saturn is all about structures. And with it conjunct Pluto, we can see the shattering of structures and systems that don't work, which is paving the way ultimately for the creation of new ones that do work better. But while that excavation is going on, it might not be so pretty. It can feel very jarring. But with this Mars activating the North Node in Cancer, you can partake of a vision quest or some kind of a effort to get a new vision, and you will feel new energy for creating something different that will give you solutions to any problems you've been experiencing from the Saturn-Pluto conjunction opposite the North Node. So Mars can be used as a lovely engine, a source of energy for you to, okay, this has been going on, I've been going along, and now it's time to do something new, to go in a new direction, to gain a new perspective, to initiate or institute a change that will create something better. And that something that you may be creating better is, of course, you know, Saturn is structures, Pluto clears out what doesn't work. And so there's been a lot of excavation going on, and now it's time to come up with solutions. What a beautiful thing to have come along for us. I am Rebecca Ann. I am your host here on SoulStream Talk. We're on the BBM Global Network, TuneIn Radio, and Spotify. I want to thank you so much for listening today, and we'll be back next Tuesday at 2 p.m.
This has been SoulStream Talk with your host, Rebecca Ann. Join us each week as Rebecca answers your questions about the issues, difficulties, and challenges you face, as well as all things spiritual and intuitive, here on SoulStream Talk.
You've been listening to the BBM Global Network. The ideas, views, and opinions of this broadcast are those of the participants of the program and are not necessarily the ideas, views, and opinions of the BBM Global Network Company.